Welcome to Wixipedia. This is my tutorial series on how to become a better builder in Planet Coaster. Today, I'm gonna give you guys 10 essential tips on how to become a better builder in Planet Coaster and Planet Zoo. Lots of these questions are questions I get asked for a lot on my stream or in my community. So hopefully by the end of this video, you will be a better builder. So sit back and enjoy. So first thing you have to consider when you do a pathing in Planet Coaster or in Planet Zoo, I will show you examples here on screen while we talk about it. So there's a certain way to do pathing in this game. We've seen it for many, many years. But one of the things that I like to do if I want to make like a sort of a circle sort of with the path, what I like to do is that I click this that says camera will follow and rotate. This means that whenever, whatever, in which direction I move my camera, it will follow with the path. So let's say I would click this here. And then I move it around here. So whenever I do this, this will now make the camera follow and I can legit make an entire circle like this. Now we have a perfect circle, which you can use by having, as I said, camera will follow and rotate. And you can legit do this in many different ways. You can even do it with a bigger path as well, if that's what you want to do. You can do it like this, boom, and just do it in circles again, like this. So you can see, it is very, very simple if you just have the camera to go like that. Then the camera will follow, and you will automatically just do a path that goes in this way. And it's the same way in Planet Zoo as well. We have the same option, and you can legit just click that and you will get the same exactly method. It's very clever and it's very simple as well, and it takes you a lot of time, especially when you are playing with this game. So the next thing I would like to show you when it comes to pathing, it's what you can do, is that you can actually control the guests flow even though you have placed them on a path. So what you can do by controlling the guest flow is that you go into props, you go into fences, and then you find these pieces called barriers or curbs. So these guys here, as you see, you have three different kinds of each of them, and what they do is that they actually block guests how they walk. So as you can see here, we have these guys walking here. So if we do this, just to elaborate what I would like to show you guys. So if we place this guy here, that will make them go different ways if they have room for it. So let's just do like this, right? So we'll place this guy here and we'll place another one here. You can also, like, if you're making a queue, then they will obviously be perfect like this. But what you can do is that they even register if you just put them underneath the ground. So let's say here you still want path, and sometimes path can be, well, an idiot in this game. We're all aware of that. So sometimes it's easier to just make a wide path and then just put these curbs and barriers down, because that in some way still makes you control the guest's flow, even though you have a bigger path. So you can still build scenery and all that stuff on it without them clipping through. As example, let's see what happens here. See how they walk straight over like to the alignment of the pathing here, and they don't even near the center, but here they do again because they have room for it. But you can't see that, right? So this is a perfect way of doing this. We can even do it while they walk here. We can do this. So they will only follow this path. See, now they will not even be able to walk anywhere except for all the way over here. So it's very simple, and as I say, you can hide these away so you can't see them in your park. So it actually just looks like that the people are, yeah, using the path as they should. So that was the curves, and that was how you made a perfect circle in this game. What you else can do is that if you press path here and you go over here, if you don't want it to attach here, you can either way hold down control. When you hold down your control button, that gives you this. So hold this down and you will have whatever free alignment you want with the path. So if like you want something that is like very close to the path, but the game just keeps on, like as you can see, it just keeps on snapping, you can press control and you can maybe even attach it very, very close to the path itself, as you can see here. And then it actually just works. And then you can always cover it up with some different kind of pieces. I don't know which kind you want, but there's all kind of floor pieces you can cover up here. So all this just becomes a hole. So people won't see that because this is just how the path is lined, right? So yeah, that was some a little tip for you there, guys, to be more exclusive with the pathing. And one more thing, if you press control, but also hold down shift, that will make you be able to move it wherever you want and move it above the ground. So if you wanted to attach it somewhere where the path itself will snap wrong, then you can just do that yourself as well. And then you can like put it up here. And then it's literally a path in the sky right now. And you can of course attach it to the other paths by just doing this, and then boom. And the path is connected. So that is pretty simple how we do this, guys. That's pretty simple how you do pathing in this game. So yeah, guys, that was just three things of how to become better at working with the path system in this game, because we all know it is a boss kill at times. Moving on. All right, so on the agenda here, I have foliage as the second point here that I would like to give you guys a quick little tour of or how things work here. So depending on what game you're playing, if you're playing Planet Coaster or Planet Zoo, we are in Planet Coaster, not so lucky to have this feature that they have in Planet Zoo now, that automatically can rotate your foliage, trees, etc. But one rookie mistake you see a lot of times is tree placement like this. As you see here, the whole texture of the trees here, it just doesn't work. As you can see, even from far away, it's very weird to have it standing like this. And it's a common mistake a lot of people do, and it's not something a lot of people think about, because in Planet Zoo there is a feature that you can click and then it will automatically rotate your trees. With that said, is that let me just try to elaborate here and try to give you guys two examples of what is hot and what is not. Okay, so every time you place a tree down, remember to press the Z button. Every time you click that, it will rotate your trees automatically. So this is a thing that can make your trees look a lot better with just one click on your keyboard. You can see there's a slider difference on how this is placed. This is the whole texture all the way through, where here you get a little bit of different kinds of trees, even though it is the same tree. It's a very, very common mistake. So in Planet Zoo, you have this extra feature you have to take off down here, where it literally just do this for you, where you don't have to click any buttons or do it yourself. So you don't have to think about it there. But in Planet Coaster, it is very important you do this, because you will get a whole other different result with these guys. And what you can do even more to make it look even better is you can lower them a bit more below the ground, so some of them in the background don't look like as much as the same. And also just give it some more variety, and you can even change it up with smaller and bigger trees as well. I just used one tree here as an example, but if we have to make a forest in here, what is really nice is that you use different types of them, place them around in here, and even mix it up with a few other trees that is sort of the same biome as this tree. It could be like the alpine here, you know. Like, this literally just does so much to whatever you're doing. If it's a forest area, it's a tree sort of passage you're working on. But it just does a lot. Also with your rock placements. See, if you just place one of the same rocks, this is a great example too. Like you can see, it's the same freaking rock you've placed down with the same texture. If you do that opposite, you do like here, like that, you can legit use this rock four times. you can put this rock on top of each other and actually just make a bigger rock out of that without actually seeing that it's the same rock you've used. So it's very important that you try sometimes to figure out where to make it look authentic and like, you know, realistic in a way when you do these things. And it also, again, it goes with bushes too, because you notice it with the bushes as well. See this. See, everything is just needs to be different, and then you can always like move it around, lower it to the ground, move this guy up a bit, and always turn him. And then of course with a lot more sections. Then it comes to become a little bit better. And always just remember to mix up stuff. It's always nice to mix up stuff with each other. So you get these sort of bushes like you see in real life and stuff, right? And also like next to the rocks here. All these things are super important if you want to build a bigger project or make a blueprint where you can like can cram pack so many things. As you can see here, I also used a lot of different foliage where some of it is, you can barely see some of it because it is just poking outside, just kissing the surface just a tiny bit, because then you can get like these sort of cool like grass vibes, you know, like where it actually looks like shrubs and grass and all kind of stuff, where in Planet Zoo again they have that already, so in that way you don't have to do that as much, but it really really helps on the things that you can see here, guys. Just adding these things around here, you know, just add many things. So yeah, I think that was pretty much what we got to cover here in the foliage and kind of like scenery point of view, and what I have of tips for you there, guys. So let's move on to number 3. All right, guys. So I get a lot of questions about where I get my inspiration from and my reference from. And I can tell you that I have my own personal Pinterest folder where I literally hide and save all my inspiration that I want. This is one of the things I can recommend you to do as well. There's ArtStation, there's DeviantArt, there's Google, there's Pinterest, there's so many things where you can get inspiration from. And I have used not even 10% of this folder, as you can see here. I have plenty of stuff that can keep me going for days, for months, which is literally is. And sometimes I don't even need these. I can just, you know, build whatever I feel like building myself. So like it's really really cool to do this, guys. As you can see, I have Main Street Townhouse, Mediterranean, Fantasy, Medieval, Industrial, and then I have some others that I've found lately, you know. And you can keep it on like this with like organizing it and stuff, and there's just so many things to get you started. Or you can also decide to go into the workshop and pick up people's creations that they've done and look at them, how they've done it. They subscribe to a piece on the workshop and they literally just see what's out there and how people have built them. They tear it apart, they see what kind of pieces they've used and etc. All those kind of things really, really helps you as well to become a better builder. So yeah, guys, go make a Pinterest folder, find some inspiration and get started. And yeah, that is pretty much how I get my inspiration from and how I just keep on going with these sort of things. All right, guys, the next thing that I would like to tell you guys a little bit about is keybinds in this game. There's a lot of different ways of using them and how to become a better and faster builder by using the keybinds in the game. So what I'm gonna tell you now is just a few things about how you can do it. So first thing is that you can always click here. Every time you multi-select stuff, you have to remember to hold down left shift. Left shift makes you multi-select all the pieces that you want. So as you can see here, now we have these guys. So if you want to move these, we can't by clicking X when we have them selected. If you click the button X after you've selected them, you can legit just do whatever you please with all the pieces. You can press X again and you will get the axes of the buildings, so you can do legit whatever you want. As you can see here, you can move them, you can move them like this. There are so many different ways you can do that. So keep in mind to hold down shift when you are multi-selecting pieces. And if you then do this, let's just say that you regret that you took some of the pieces, but you don't want to start all over. You can click control, and control should deselect the piece you don't want to move. So control and left shift are very important key players here, guys. You really have to remember those. They are very, very important. After you've built something, and if you kind of regret it, you can also use control and Y or Z, which literally makes you go back and do things. Let's say I'll do this here as an example, but I don't want this to be here afterwards. I feel like, so instead of just deleting them like this, I can press control Z and that will remove it. And if I want to have it back, I can press control and then Y again, and it should somewhat come back. One thing I also would like to talk to you guys about and teach you is the camera movement. If you click at the button T, your camera should be way smoother and a lot slower to move around, as you can see here. As you can see here. If you press T again, as we do now, you can see the camera moves a lot faster than it usually has to do. And this can sometimes be an issue if you're building way above the surface or way below the surface. Then the camera literally just completely fucks up. So it's very nice to have that option that you can click T and then you can have a way more steadier movement with what you do in the game. So yeah, detailing, guys. When it comes to detailing, it's very important to remember on how things look in real life. What can you relate to the buildings you're building? What's going to be the selling point of your building? All these things play a very important factor when it comes to build shops and detailing them. If you're building a shop in this case, it's very important to get stuff outside. In this case, we have a souvenir shop. And as you can see, I put all the stuff outside that I feel like it is an important selling factor for the shop. And then it will actually attract to make people go inside to see what else is in there. In this case, we have a souvenir shop where we have the inside is a very low budget, very themeless shop inside where it literally just have what it needs. This is just an example of things you can do with when it comes to detailing. Detailing can involve a lot of things. It can also be the exterior of your park. It can be like this sort of plaza here where we have a fountain, we have some benches, we have a building on the right. And just all this shot here, the composition of things is very, very important. It's very important that whenever you try to build something to see how it looks from afar, see how it mingles with everything else. So when it comes to it all, guys, detailing is just all about how you feel like a building should be. Always look at reference pictures, look at how interiors look. Look how you can do things, what pieces you can use all the time. Just keep on evolving. Like, I took some references on how I feel like a real arcade should look like and how it looks from the last ones I've been at. And that's kind of like how I imagined this arcade here and how I did it. Just very important you get all these things figured out before you start acting and building interiors. Because then you can get stuff to look like this and it just makes everything looks 10 times better. So everything is just take some reference pictures, see how it looks like, and then just go ham with it, guys. Next thing I would like to share with you guys and just tell you guys a little bit about, it's a very short thing here, is how to take screenshots in this game. There's very many different ways of doing that. You obviously see a lot of people take screenshots like this, where they just go close to a building, and then they just take a picture with all the huts and everything on. You can avoid all these things. First, we are not so spoiled in Planet Coaster as we are in Planet Zoo. In Planet Zoo, you already have a feature now in the new update that makes you go into free loop mode, which is literally Tidget Cam view, which you do here. You click a random yes and you write Tidget Cam. Wherever you have your mouse cursor is pretty much where you're gonna land. So Tidget Cam is a guest perspective sort of thing, where you can go down on the peeps view and then it literally makes you walk around like this. Some extra tips I can do here is that if you are one of those that make cinematic videos, Tidget Cam is a very cool way of doing that. You can even zoom in on stuff, so you actually get like a super cool immersive shot that actually involves a lot of things, a lot of detailing. And if you're one of those that do videos, you can always click T and the mouse cursor here will disappear. So now you have a clean shot of everything and you don't need to make sure or think about that you have stuff in the picture. So what you can do now is that you can hold your shift button, and the shift button will make you go slow. You can see now I'm not holding the shift button, so we'll go faster, and now we'll go slow again. And in that way, while you have your cursor removed, you can move around like this, so it actually feels like you're walking around in your park. And you can zoom in on other stuff as well. This is very important, and whenever you just feel like you have a great shot, I like to take shots that has a lot of things, that is not just the building itself you're making. So if it's possible for you to take a shot where you can get lots more stuff in it, that's something I can recommend. Let's just try here, for example. See this shot here. We have some trees. We have different buildings. This is a great shot you can take here. A lot of things is happening on this picture. It makes people curious, and it just gives a lot, you know. So this is one of the things that you can do. And I don't know which software you use, NVIDIA, if you use just Steam screenshot or whatever, but it's literally just take screenshots with your software whenever you feel like you have what you need. This will also be a great screenshots from over here, where we get all the coasters, we get the arcade, we get the Ferris wheel. Just all these things here really, really makes the immersive experience a lot better when you do these things. So this was just a quick thing of how you take screenshots. There's also ways you can do by going in and play around with the camera effects, as you can see that the game offers you here. There's a lot of people that you should reshape, which I do in my case. As you can see here, this looks crazy. But this is also something you can play around with in the game. So yeah, to take or get better screenshots. And also, how to remove the HUD, guys. To remove the HUD, you press right shift and right control and G. This will make the entire HUD of the game disappear, so you can take smooth and clean screenshots without having anything else in the way. Yeah, alright guys, well, let's move on to the next. So one of the things I can recommend too when you start up in this game is that don't start too big, start small. Make small blueprints of the same theme. Get to know the pieces, get to know what kind of pieces that you feel like is most important in your building repertoire sort of thing. As you can see here we have like a few bunches of some Western builds that I did in the past compared to a building I did a few months back. These three first buildings you see is some of my first builds compared to a last build I did 6-7 months ago. So you can see there's a big difference when it comes to building and how to start. There's no need to start going crazy big because it's just too much for you to handle. Also, to get a good influence in how things work in this game, and you'll figure out what pieces that will be your favorite pieces and etc. So it's also just very good to fill up your workshop with all kinds of different themes. As you can see here, we have cabins, there's Viking builds in, there is lodges, there is small Chinese oriental steampunk cars I've done, right? There's small carriages, there is freaking Vespas I did. There's so many things in this game I've done, and it literally all of it made me such a good builder. So start making small blueprints, fill up your workshop, make shop skins, make ride skins, make small coaster blueprints before you even start thinking about making a park. At least get to know the pieces in the game. As you can see, there's so many different things you can build. So yeah, that's just a few things that I would like to say about how you should start building in this game, or in Planet Zoo for that matter. It works both ways in both games. So when you feel like you got what you need to make a park, or actually take the chances, try do this a little mini park as me and Jure in this case have done, where we have made a little island and then we just cram pack stuff in here. And you can see some of these builds are not even that big compared to how much you can actually build here. So it's a good way to lower yourself with like don't take too many expectations to yourself. Just embrace what you have and build small, don't go overboard, because that's usually where your groove and stuff kind of like moves away. Okay guys, so I also get a lot of questions about how I upload my blueprints to the workshop or my builds to the workshop. So here I'm gonna show you like a very, very quick tutorial on how you post stuff to your workshop and actually make it better and evolve through that. So what I'm gonna show you guys here now is that I'm gonna take this guy here, which we have, and then you will have this button here that says save as blueprint. When you click this, a new page comes up for you here. So you'll get this one that says my saved blueprints. In this one, you save it as a new blueprint and it will ask you about a lot of things here. So what you can do is that you can find a thumbnail that's going to represent this guy on the workshop. So this is what everyone is going to see when they look at it on the workshop. So you can see right here. So let's just call this a newspaper stand, right? Let's call that that. And then you can always change it in the description afterwards when you have posted it. And then you literally just find some tags for whatever it is. Since we have an animatronic, this is animatronic. And we can add a new tag that, for example, says other scenery. So we have this guy here. And then maybe we can even add a small building to it. So when you have this, and make sure that you get most of the sun on this guy. If it's not doable, then you just can't, but make sure that you got most sunlight on this guy as possible. As you can see on this side here, we already have him chosen, but this is the front, so we kind of have to have him turn around like this. So what you do here now is that you get the perfect size you want. Make sure that these squares here have something in the middle, so this is what the focus point is. So afterwards you literally just click create blueprint, and after that you can see it's saved in the corner. So what you do afterwards is that you click the My Blueprints tab. You can either way just search for it here. In this case, I have a lot of shit on mine, so it'll be crazy to go through here. So what we do here is that you can search for it. So let's say we say newspaper stand. So here it is. So what you do is that you click on your upload to Steam Workshop link, or the button here. So if you click this, a new folder is gonna come up. And this is the one that makes you put your stuff on the workshop. So you can click here, new workshop item. So now you have this newspaper stand. This is what the people see on the workshop afterwards. So here you just workshop title, workshop descriptions, whatever you feel. The tags you have are underneath here. So as people are searching for these tags in the workshop, this is what they will get. And then you click create workshop item. So what this does now is that it is uploading it to Steam and it makes you a page on your workshop where this will be set. As you can see here, now we have this on the workshop. So what you need to do now is that you can change the visibility to friends only, hidden, unlisted. In this case, I just need to make sure to show you guys, so I'm gonna make it hidden. So now no one else can see it besides me. As you can see here, this item will only be visible to you, admins, and anyone marked as a creator. So what else you do is that now you just go in and you add those required things that it needs. You can see it has an adventure, Ghostbusters, a spooky, and studios, and World's Fair. So you add those detail tags here, and then people can see what kind of DLCs they are needing to get this building. So yeah, guys, that was a very quick thing on how you upload things to the workshop. And afterwards you can add your own description, you can even add a video if you've built it in a video, and you can add some other links you can refer to. You can add contributors if you're more than yourself of building it, if it's a collaboration. There's so many things for you to do here. So I hope that this was like somewhat of a little quick tutorial for you guys to see how you upload things on the workshop. And whenever you are done with it, you just go in here and change visibility, you make it public, and then everyone else would be able to see it on the workshop. So that's how pretty much things work out with how you upload to the workshop. And it is literally the same thing in Planet Zoo as well, guys. So the last thing I would like to talk to you guys about is Theme Maker toolkit, which is somewhat of a newer thing in Planet Coaster. This is something we got in the last update at all for Planet Coaster, and this allows people, people that can use software programs as Blender, to make their own pieces in this game. Which, in this case, in Grimmskate, I have Kevin with me, which is working on so many different TeamMaker Toolkit pieces, and are actually adding to the pieces of what you can do in this game. I personally will recommend TeamMaker Toolkit pieces because they really just make you add those extra things that the normal game just doesn't have. So it literally gives you a lot more possibilities, a lot more pieces to be more creative in. So if you feel like you're missing a few pieces here and there, go into the workshop and try to find some of those TeamMaker Toolkit pieces that will really just make your build pop up that extra. You can get many, many different types of TeamMaker Toolkit pieces. There are legit so many pieces on the workshop right now. I think we have over 10,000 TeamMaker Toolkit pieces that people have been made to us in the community, so we can use them and build freely with them in this game here. And everything just makes it look so much better when you use a lot of these TeamMaker Toolkit pieces. I can literally only recommend you guys to go in, take a look and search for what you really, really need for these sort of builds. Because, like today, we have a lot of steampunk, we have fantasy, we have medieval, we have so many different pieces now that can really make your build stand out and be so much better than what you usually intended it to, because with only the in-game pieces. So if you're in the need of new pieces to evolve, I would definitely say you should take some TeamMaker Toolkit pieces, go search for it on the workshop. It is legit a whole new thing. You can make your entire new pack of what you want to do. Make collections, put them in your build together, you know, evolve like that. This is literally also one of the things that can make you a good builder. On this frame here, there we see a lot of TeamMaker Toolkit for different places that I literally mixed together. We're also making a lot of pieces that are only made for our project. So yeah, go check out the workshop, guys. You will see many, many pieces of TeamMaker Toolkit in there. Whatever you need is literally on there. But make sure you don't use too many, because it can literally make your game run very unstable. So yeah, just go check out on the workshop what kind of TeamMaker Toolkit pieces you can have. It is literally just to go in, implant in on the workshop, tag the TeamMaker Toolkit, and you will get the latest TeamMaker Toolkit pieces of what people have done. We have animated pyre wheel from Curious Mind. There is a 30 mile per hour sign by Little Socks. There is from Churro a graffiti tag. There is some toads from Magikazoo. There is, like, guys, there is so many things here. You can legit download to yourself and use them in your park. And it literally just makes everything so much better. And it can also make you earn time of not going in and build something completely custom made when someone already made it in this game. So yeah, don't hesitate to use a few pieces if you really need it, because they have so many things in here that can literally make your park project blueprint stand up so much better, guys. And literally the only thing you have to do is click on them and you just click subscribe. Luckily I already have subscribed to this piece, but it is literally that simple, and the game will just then download it for you. So yeah, if you are in the need of TeamMaker Toolkit, guys, and you are kind of stuck with the DLCs and whatnot we got in the game, then I can definitely recommend TeamMaker Toolkit pieces. The last thing that I would like to say to you guys is one thing you can also do if you want to become a better builder is to become a member in one of the many, many communities we have all the way around in the Planet Coaster, including my own, which is linked down below if you want to. But these sort of things literally just makes everything so much better, guys. There's so many things you can do in a community. As the video you're seeing in the background here now is literally our community park that we have in our community, which have over 20 people combined together. And these sort of things is just, they just work so well, especially if you want to become a better builder, if you want to learn how to interact with the community. All of these things really does a great impact, a great factor on how you are going to be building for the future. Because mingling with a community literally makes you, like, it makes you on the point. You can share with each other, you can get feedback, everything can go back and forth. So it's really important to do that, to join a community don't sit alone, because it literally just makes the experience and the game so much funnier to have someone to talk to about it with. So yeah, and also we also have plenty of contests. You can see we have also many contests, which also can make you such a better builder in Planet Coaster. Being able to work with someone that is a different level of your skill set, or can build something else of a theme than you, and have those two things combined, literally just also makes everything so much better and make you realize how many things you can actually add and build by using or looking at the person you're building with's buildings. Like, how did he do it, etc. There are so many things that makes a great factor here, guys. So remember that. In this case, we were having a duo contest, which literally means that two random persons gets together to build a part together for some certain limitations and some restrictions, as you can see here in the background. Here we had Coaster Cat and Cake 2 building something together, which never have built anything together before. And they actually won our contest. So don't hesitate to make collabs or start a collab with someone. It literally just makes you that better builder. And also, as many of you have seen lately, we just had our resort contest. And in that way, again, I give people some restrictions, some rules that they have to build for, and they do it. And then therefore it challenges you. It challenges you constantly to become a better builder on how you can evolve. How can you make something stand out here compared to others? You know, nothing that it hassles you or stresses you in that way. That's not the point. But just that it gives you the motivation to do better. That's sort of what I'm trying to say. So guys, honestly, join a community if you aren't already in one. And of course, join the club if that's what you want, because we are a big community. We are grooving, that's what we're to. We are growing as well. We are getting bigger and bigger every day. And we're just right now started a new duo contest, which is gonna start by the start of May. So yeah, this was mainly what I had to tell to you guys about this little how to become a better builder by joining a community, by joining collabs, by joining contests, etc. So that was the end of my Wixipedia tutorial video. I hope you guys get these 10 essential tips in your mind, and it will only make you a better builder from now on if you keep having all these in your head while you build. Guys, thank you so much for watching. Leave a like and a comment down below. And if you want more tutorial videos on etc. Planet Zoo, Planet Coaster, you just let me know. Also, join the community. Links are down in the description. Take care, guys. Have a great day, and I'll see you next time. Bye.